And my early teachings were of the Christian faith.
Mm-hmm.
And as upon now, as I look out upon the world, and it's always been a thing with me, to feel that all men know the truth.
Mm-hmm.
See?
I see.
And so therefore I've always felt that even though a man was not a Christian,
mm-hmm.
he still had to know the truth some way or another.
Mm-hmm.
Or if he was a Christian, he could know the truth.
Mm-hmm.
Or he could not. It's according to whether he knew the truth.
Mm-hmm.
And the truth itself mm-hmm. doesn't have any name on it to
right.
me.
See? Mm-hmm.
And each man has to find this for himself, I think.
Hello, vinyl community. I'm back with you again to do another video. This time, I'm talking about A77 and another album. So what is A77? Well, A77 just happens to be one of the greatest jazz albums of all time. It happens to be A Love Supreme by John Coltrane. So what brought me to this album? At least bringing it to you this week. So someone alerted me to this guy. A Love Supreme, The Complete Masters, which just came out for the 50th anniversary of this album. And what can I say about this album that hasn't been said before? This is just an incredible album. It's made so many lists. It's on Rolling Stone's top 500 albums of all time. It's received the prestigious Penguin Jazz 5 star or crown rating, which is a rarity for the Penguin Jazz book. This is John Coltrane's magnum opus, his love letter to God. It is kind of a non-denominational, non-dogmatic praise of the Lord and his thank you to him. In 1957, John Coltrane had a spiritual reawakening. He was kicked out of the Miles Davis Quintet at the time because of his heroin use. And in that same year, he just happened to kick the habit and he had a spiritual reawakening. And, you know, he had a lot of thoughts collected, and the sum up of the experience came out in this album, which was recorded in December of 64. What makes this album so unique is, number one, it has a white spine, and the Impulse albums have a traditional orange and black, but this one is unique, and I can't find anything that really explains why they gave this one a white spine. Maybe someone found or felt that this was historically significant and just gave it a white spine. There is a book written about this entire album by Ashley Kahn, who also put together a nice booklet for this reissue. And maybe it's in that book, I don't know. If you know why this was given a white spine, please let me know, I'm very curious. But this just happens to have two additional LPs of outtakes, and the outtakes are very impressive. So originally when he conceived this, he was thinking of a big band setting, but it was recorded over 3 or 4 days, and they happened to find from his estate some of the sextet sessions, which includes Art Davis and Archie Shepp, which people knew was in existence because he just happens to thank the individuals, Archie Shepp and Art Davis here. And, you know, the other thing that makes this so unique is, you know, there is a poem, A Love Supreme, which is a nice poem that Coltrane wrote, which is his thank you to God. And in here he just talks about, you know, the people that are going to listen to this particular album and thanking them and thanking God for being able to make people happy with his music. This is just a wonderful album, and it's a unique experience. So if you're a first time listener, all I can say is you gotta listen to this all the way through. If you listen to the first couple minutes, 3 minutes, you might be immediately turned off. It's a little discordant at the beginning, but you know, if you listen to acknowledgement all the way through to the point where you know you get to the chanting, and John Coltrane chants here A Love Supreme continuously. I promise once you get into resolution, pursuance, and psalm, you'll be rewarded at the end. If you have the CD version of this, and I'm hoping to pick that up sometime, you actually get the only full-fledged live performance of this particular four-piece suite. And this is really well done. Impulse Universal, they have an association with United. This was pressed at United because you see the little U here. And what I can say is it is not bad. It is really good. So I played it in comparison to my 45 RPM pressing by Analog Productions, mastered by Kevin Gray and Steve Hoffman. I think, I'm pretty sure Kevin Gray did the mastering. I'm not sure if Steve Hoffman did it with this, but it is pretty darn close. There is, if you listen closely here, you'll hear some marginal differences. In the 45 RPM, the bass and the drum sections I felt are a little more refined, a little more defined. This one is a little bit murky, but not so much. It's not as bad as the Black Sabbath comparison that I did previously. That one was striking, but this one is minimal. So it came with a wonderful book done by Ashley Kahn. It has a very nice essay, and it includes photos. So, you know, very cool. And, you know, it comes with his original notes and markup, the original write-up of his poem that went in the interior. We got some nice shots of the band in the process of recording. Shot of the original tapes, so you know you can't beat the quality of this book. So I can't recommend this enough. This is definitely a must-own album for everyone, in my opinion. Now the next item that I have is another one by Coltrane, which is Coltrane's Sound. This happens to be a Vinyl Me Please add-on, but you can get it through other music retailers. This is an ORG repressing of Coltrane Sound, 45 RPM set. Of course, because it was 45, they had to make it a gatefold. It wasn't originally issued as a gatefold. They did 2,000 copies. And this is just outstanding. It was mastered by Bernie Grumman, who is probably one of the best in the business. The cover is done by an artist named Marvin Israel, and I think he was under contract for Atlantic to do four covers. Two of the ones that I remember off the top of my head are Charles Mingus and then Sonny Stitt, and I think he did Milt Jackson as well. So very kind of avant-garde painting. And this is mainly hard bop, I want to say, a little bit modal. It does feature a couple of covers. You know, after A Love Supreme, John Coltrane said, I'm not doing covers anymore. His music became more free, which is what's so wonderful about Coltrane. He just evolved as a musician, and the best musicians do evolve. And, you know, for each stage that they're evolving to, they master it. And he was just a master, by all means. But it does feature a few original tracks, Equinox, Satellite, Liberia. Those are ones that, you know, I really recommend. Equinox in particular is very much a standout track here. So definitely worth picking up. This is, you know, a solid Coltrane album. You know, if you look at the jazz guides, I mean, they give it a 4 out of 5 star rating. I happen to like it. When he transitioned to 65 to a more freer, spiritual type jazz, you know, critics love it, but, you know, it's not my cup of tea, but this is just excellent. It was issued after I left Atlantic, so, you know, Atlantic and Prestige were taking advantage of things after he departed the label. So that's what I got for you this week. I do have a question for you guys, at least you jazz collectors out there. Do you guys organize your collection by label, or do you do it strictly by artist? I find that I'm doing a combination of both. Like, if the label is distinct, like Impulse, I feel compelled to put them all together. I'm just curious what everybody else does. But thank you for watching. If you have any comments, you got feelings about A Love Supreme, you disagree with me, agree with me, shoot them down below. And thank you for watching.
A lot of younger musicians were hanging around with Elvin Jones, and they were talking about, man, you know, we hear the intensity you guys played when you were playing with Coltrane. I mean, what was that like? How do you, like, play with that kind of intensity? And Elvin looks at him and says, you gotta be willing to die with a motherfucker. And then they started laughing like kids do, waiting for the punchline. And then they realized somewhere in the middle of that he was serious. How many people do you know that are willing to die, period? Die with anybody. And when you listen to those records, that's exactly what they sound like. I mean, that they would die for each other.